यू आर देयर फिजिकली, यू कैन जस्ट हैंडल ऑल द टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम्स डायरेक्टली ऑन द ग्राउंड. राइट नाउ हाफ ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम्स बिगिन विद कैन यू हेयर मी, एंड हाफ ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम्स एंड विद कैन यू हेयर मी, येस आई कैन हेयर यू. These are the two statements that we start with, and at the end we get to know that okay, you can hear me now. We should go on. Multiple technical issues and multiple errors that are there due to our digital webinars. But the beauty of these webinars is basically, you know, you can sit anywhere and just by clicking on one particular link, you can join the webinars. It's like a ocean of education and knowledge in just one click. And that's the beauty of these webinars. So I would like to start. Hello and welcome to everyone present here. Before we start with our webinar, may I request everyone to switch on your cameras, please? It would be really nice to see all your faces. Our speaker has taken so much effort to come here, and he has taken a lot of preparations and a lot of knowledge, and he's gathered everything, his experience, his expertise, to just to share with all of you. So we are currently not only at Zoom, the platform of Zoom, but we are also live on our Facebook page. So we have viewers from over there and also from here. So we would like them to see faces of our guests. So can we take a small like 10 seconds and we can just start with all the cameras there, all of the cameras of all the members here. This is perfect. I can see many people are switching on their cameras, and this is really great response. And I hope we have this the same entire response throughout the webinar. I have kept every one of you on mute so that the session goes smoothly. You will be unmuted during our Q&A sessions, question and answer sessions at the end. So let us get started. Welcome aboard all members. As you can see, as I had mentioned earlier on, we are on a ship. And we are going to swim the ocean of knowledge, which is going to be guided by our captain, architect Raghuveer Katpalia. Please forgive me if I take the name or the surname as an error or something. I really understand the value of a name that is there. So if there's any mistake, please do correct me. So I would like to extend a warm welcome to all our members present here today. My name is Shubhansh Nigam, and I'm going to be your host for this webinar. It is really great to have see such great participation, and we thank you for the same. With this, I'm going to start our session. The first thing that we're looking at is, what is C3? You have come to our platform, you have come to our webinar, but what does collaboration, what does C3 mean? So whenever we have to answer this particular question, we are looking at what does collaboration mean? In simple terms, collaboration is a mutual understanding between two or more parties to work together for betterment of all with a single agenda. It's the same thing on the same concept. C3 has been working for the betterment of all AEC professionals. We are not only looking at one particular sector of our field, of our industry, but we're looking at overall the growth of each and every professional of our industry. To put it in a really simple terms, C3 is a digital marketplace for construction industry. It is an online collaborative platform that thrives to help professionals from the AEC industry to evolve from a hyper-local mindset to a global mindset by providing them amazing opportunities from project owners all over the world. With the help of our particular platform, with the help of C3's platform, you can collaborate with other AEC professionals, showcase your profiles, and get projects from clients. So we are not only looking at for the benefit of our professionals, but we're also looking for the benefit of our clients. This goes both ways. With this, coming to the next point, C3 so far. So far, we have been focusing more on our interior sector. As you can see, we have introduced more of our new landing page, which is www.interior.c3.com. And till now, we have more than 500 leads in such a short duration of time. The statistics that I'm showing to you right now is an aggregate of just 3 months. We have more than 500 leads. We have over 90 clients. And we have over 3,000 members as professionals in our collaborative platform. C3 has been focusing more on bringing in more clients in the interior sector as of yet, but we are expanding to other sectors day by day. So you don't have to worry about, if you will get leads or if you get clients or not. We'll be doing both. And the best part is we are not only just looking at the clientele side, but we're also looking for the beneficials of the professionals. So we are going to have various activities and we are going to introduce a lot of lead generation activities for our professionals as well. Now, as you know about the company, let me talk about the visionary, the whole reason for the existence of C3 Collaborative. Now, whenever you look at C3 Collaborative, you imagine where did it all start? It started with an idea converted into a vision by C3's founder and CEO, our very own Karan Athodaria, architect Karan Athodaria. He devoted himself in bringing prosperity and success to all professionals and clients connected with that AEC industry. That is the core aim of through which he started his C3 Collaborative journey. Earlier, before C3 Collaborative, with 10 years of experience as an architect, Karan Athodaria found various gaps in our AEC industry and worked towards the solution for the same. Given his collaboration experience with multiple architects and vendors, he featured for a 4 lakh square feet project. He has a brief idea about how collaboration can really help and how it can take your business to a larger level. It was during this pandemic era when we were all locked up in our particular houses, where architect Karan Athodaria realized there is a need for a digital facelift for the AEC industry. As every sector, every particular business were moving on, and they were having a digital front through which they can promote their business, they can come and they can, consult their clients and grow their business digitally. Karan Athodaria said, why can't the AEC industry do the same? Why can't we do the exact same thing as we had done earlier on? So he came with the platform of C3 Collaborative. C3 Collaborative is a single point of contract that provides professionals to expand globally and clients to get work easily. Basically, with the vision, we wanted to create more work opportunities for all architecture, engineering, and construction professionals. Now, I would like to explain the recent activities that we had done earlier on, and there will be more, but I just wanted to give you a small brief about what C3 Collaborative has done for our professionals. First, for networking purposes, we had introduced with our Telegram group. Imagine a single platform where you can approach any specialized professional according to your needs digitally. You don't have to travel anywhere. You just need to drop a message into a particular group, and you just need to drop what your requirements are, and we will connect you to the right professional, or you can connect to the right professional directly. That's what our aim was when we started the Telegram group. The one particular thing that we really wanted to do was we wanted all AEC professionals to come on our platform and interact with each other. The more you interact with each other, the more you know about the other person. The more you know about the other person, you understand what he's good at and what he's not good at. Once you have a brief idea about the entire thing, then you guys can collaborate and work together according to the requirements that you have. To have this particular networking and to have that particular interaction, we introduced a quiz competition for all our professionals. Now, this was just an icebreaking that we wanted to do so that the people or our AEC professionals can come together and start interacting with each other. And we were quite successful. The entire quiz went on for 15 days, out of which we had more than 50 members participating each day. They were not only putting up the right answers, but they were also interacting with us and each other regarding the questions and how we conducted the entire competition. At the end, we did choose our winners, and we gave them prizes that as promised. We also have on our Instagram Live, we have introduced with a live talk show. Now, in this talk show, we wanted in this particular sector, we wanted to spread the same education knowledge that we can have, but in a very short clip. So as a similar pattern to a live talk show, we brought our professionals on our particular platform, and we tried to spread their experience and their expertise through different various questions as you do in a particular live talk show. And that also gave us a great response. And later on, we moderated the entire video and circulated to our professionals so that, you know, it's not limited to the people who have watched this, but post that, they were also able to see it. And last, we have conducted many webinars. This is going to be our 10th webinar that we had conducted. You can visit our website and see the other webinars. And we put all the link of the webinar on our YouTube channel. I will be passing all the links to our social media and Telegram group in the chat box as soon as I hand over it to Raghuveer sir. Coming to our current webinar, as we are talking about the webinars, coming to our particular topic right now, our honorable guest, architect Raghuveer sir, is going to talk about on the topic of the home as a certain condition of the landscape. Even though if I tried to justify his introduction, it won't be enough, because at such a young age, he has achieved so much that it becomes a dream for other people, and it is a bigger influence that makes us drive that we can do better. So to start with a very small introduction about Raghuveer sir, he graduated from Navratna University with a bachelor's degree in architecture. His thesis focused on what was the physical importance of everyday object in the process of the homemaking. Then he went on to build a home in Sanand that got published in numerous international publications on the social media platforms. I will also be sending you the link of this particular article. So if you want to go through it, you can definitely go it. He's currently working with Vastu Shilp Consultants Ahmedabad, Sangat B.V. Doshi's firm, and is currently involved in various projects and the design and execution of various projects of varying scales, from individual homes to housing to institutional projects. Even though I tried, as I said earlier on, even if I tried to put a very brief introduction about sir, I won't be able to do it on a much larger scale. So why don't I let our speaker, architect Raghuveer Katpalia, to take over and start with his presentation, and start with a little small introduction about himself. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much for the introduction. I think I'll start with my presentation, and one second, let me just share. Thank you for having me over here to deliver this talk. I'm very grateful for your invitation. I looked at what I'd presented earlier, and I thought that maybe I will present a few more projects. And so I changed the title of the presentation. Excuse me for doing that. And now it's called What Has Changed? An Approach to Design. So in this presentation, I'm going to be talking about my design process and my approach to architecture. And I would like to first start by defining the goal of my practice, which is made of two parts. It's a twofold goal, which is, one is to reimagine the built environment, because I feel that the built environment is something that is constantly evolving, and the needs of the people are constantly evolving, and hence it needs to be reimagined from again and again. We need to keep on reimagining how we deal with the built environment, because ultimately we are looking at a relationship of how we occupy the environment, and that relationship is something that needs to constantly evolve with changes that take place. And the second part is to have a rational basis for that new way of being with the environment. So the first is to reimagine. This is what I think is very important and is necessary. And the second is to have a rational basis for why we reimagine the way we do. So I think the important, that leads me to what is an important question for being able to look at how we reimagine, is I ask these questions: what has changed, how we used to live, and how we live now. So I've broken it down into three crucial dimensions, as I call them. And they are basically related to the past, the present, and the future. So in the past, this is when one looks at buildings, I would say one needs to know the history of that type of building, or the typology, and how the typology has evolved over time. The second would be to look at the present, one has to look at the physical context as it is today. And the future, one has to look at dreams and needs and of the clients and stakeholders and of the environment and make projections. So these are the projects, four projects I shall be talking about. The first one is titled A Home as a Condition of the Landscape, which is a house in Ahmedabad, in Sanand. The second one is called Gathering and Watching, which is a home in Jamnagar. The third is Pukur in the Sky, which is a tower that we are doing currently in Calcutta. And the third is A Culture of Roofs, which is a school that we are doing in Chennai. So the first project, A Home as a Condition of the Landscape. So we often live in disconnected boxes where there's a very clear distinction between the indoors and outdoors. There's this very clear binary which exists, where there's a house and then there's the landscape.
I'm sorry to disturb you, but we cannot see your screen, sir.
Oh, you cannot?
Yeah.
Is it visible?
Yeah, it's visible now. Thank you.
Yeah. So this is the image. So I was saying that usually the conventional house that we look at is basically there's a house and then there's the landscape which is outside. And so the house is basically this box. So it's a sort of a container which contains different rooms. So this sort of shows the kind of room. There's a box with a lot of rooms in it. But then I think of the past and I think of like how people have lived here. And we've been a people of the land. And so this is a photograph of Kutch and the Bhunga houses that are there. And if you see there is a cluster of houses. And then this landscape, which is there in between the houses, is a part of the home. So there is a difference between the house and the home. Nowadays, we talk of the house, but the home extends beyond. It is wherever we feel safe, sheltered, and that environment, that is the home. So I wanted to build a home and not just a house for the client who had come. So I said, why not unbox and unpack from that box? And there was a certain program that was given to me. And then I said that, why don't we separate all of those things? And then the space in between, which is the landscape that's there, becomes a part of the home. And then you get places where there are trees, because the site had a lot of existing trees which were there. And you get places where you can stand and see, and you get otlas, and you get all of these things which have historically been there because we have been a people of the land. So it's about a certain occupation and inhabitation of the land, and it's not about just the house. So that's the image. This is what got built. And as you can see through and through the home. The landscape, this was the trees that are there are part of the house. And the built that is there, they're together. They're not two separate things. That binary is not as clear. The way it was in that picture where you saw of the Bhungas, where all the things in between were equally a part of the home. So when we build a building, also what happens is that you're given a piece of land. Usually you're given something, a plot which is there, which has definite boundaries. But there are a lot of things that are there from before on that piece of land. And once one builds on that piece of land, so one sees, so this happened to me. So I go to the site and I see what's there on site. And then one thinks of the fact that when I build here, what will become of that same piece of land? How will I see over that, you know, I could see all of that land and all of these connections between the trees and all of these things that existed. Now, when I build, what will happen to those connections? Will I still be able to see over the land? Will I still be able to see the tree that I saw there? How will I position the house so that my house and my activities happen around what was already there? So the idea of what will happen, will one be able to traverse over the land the same way or as one could before is an important question to me. So that's the building that got built. And as you can see, these are existing trees that are there. And this was taken during the client's wedding. So as soon as the house got built, he got married. And as you can see, it's actually five distinct building blocks which have been separated with verandas in between. And these are some images which show that tree behind, which was there, is an existing tree, and you enter from there. And so that's the plan. So if you can see that there are these five distinct, is my cursor visible?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, okay. So you can see the five distinct building blocks that are there. These are the five sort of distinct building blocks that are there. And then the landscape goes through, and these are all existing trees. All of these that are not undotted are all existing trees, and they've all been retained. So that was the initial rendering that had been done. And this is the kind of section where you get a part, this side, you get the master bedroom, you get a veranda, a very deep veranda, and then you get a tree. And then again, you get a veranda and you get the living space with the dining and the kitchen. And then over that, the roof becomes a landscape, because you get the roofs are of varying heights. So it's like, you know how you see in a cityscape, you see all of these roofs. Here in Ahmedabad, we have Uttarayan, which is celebrated, which is a kite flying festival. And you go and you see on the roof, you get all of these people on the roofs, and you get this landscape of all of these roofs of varying heights. And so this sort of creates that kind of landscape. And because of the modulation of the interior space, the result is that on top you get a landscape. And then the trees are, so it's a single story structure. And then there are trees. So when you climb onto that landscape, you're amongst the trees. So this is what you can see through and through the house. So here, if you see, this is a tree which was planted later, but there's Parijat trees. So you get smells and everything. And there's a Lebanon, this is a Lebanon tree. So this is the living space. This is a courtyard which was there. And then you see the master bedroom. So everything opens up and you see through and through the house. The way you could see over the land parcel in that Kutch thing, where you could see across, and the in-between space that was there, the negative space, became habitable. And so this is another picture that's there. That's of the main courtyard which is there. And that's an existing tree that was there, that served as an anchor. And this side is the dining space. Then I built a little stage here so that he wanted to host some performances and things. And the other side where you saw those steps, so people come and sit here. So his wedding people sat all around here in this veranda, on the terrace, all over. And then they attended. His baby was, the client's baby was here. And they all attended the function like that. So then the real room, so this was this, the living space becomes enclosed by all of these buildings which have been built. So that's another photograph that shows the master bedroom. Yeah, this is when you see from outside. And then there are other courts also in the house. And you are always seeing through the landscape. Yeah, this is what it looks like. Yeah, and you see across. And so that's what the building looks like. That's the sort of form that the building got because of the modulation that was inside. So you get the terraces, which are of different levels. And that's the landscape of its own. Once some of the trees grow a little taller, then you will be amongst the trees. The next project that I'll be talking about is a home in Jamnagar. Where the main preoccupation was about looking at how a family can gather and watch. And so here in the first project, I had a lot of land and I didn't have to build too much. But here I had the constraint of land, and there were two common walls, a corner plot. If I show you, it's a corner plot like this. And there's a constraint of land, so I get two common walls. But one side, I get a common plot. So I looked at the present scenario of where and how do people gather and how do they see. So this is again like this is a row house where you see that you have two common walls and there is one front face and you get the street. But where are people gathering and what are they seeing? And so historically, this is how people gathered and how they watched. And that was such a crucial thing because on the Ghats, I recently visited Banaras. And I went to Assi Ghat, and in the evening, like on a Sunday, everybody comes there. A lot of the city comes to the Ghats, and everyone sits and just watches. watches the river, and that's quite a important thing, just to sit and watch, and especially for a home. I think for even the first one was concerned with how does one see across the landscape. Again, here I wanted to show that if in a tight space, where will the people gather and what will they see? So this is the kind of section that got built. So there's a common plot on this side, but I created these steps here. It was very tight, but all the living spaces have been put here. So the dining, the living, and then this space, which is here, which serves as a place for gathering and watching and seeing the common plot or that's there on the northern side was there. So that was the plot, and this is what happened. This is sectionally, this is what happens. You get this thing, which is much like in a city, you know, in a city, you get this. When you build multiple houses, you get these places from where you can see vantage points. And from some of the bedrooms, you can, so from, if you see in this section, from some of the bedrooms and other living rooms, you can look into the main living space. So there are all of these connections, which are like in an urban condition, where you can see across, in the olden times, when you had multiple houses that were built around a courtyard, like the four houses here in Ahmedabad, you could look in and out and see across like that. The same way you can see across the house and you can look at the common plot, which is the only thing sort of that you get a view of because of the constraint of two common walls. So yeah, this is the kind of plan that sort of emerged. It was a very small house that had to be done, and that's sort of the rendering that's been given. This is right now under construction at the moment. The next one is Pukur in the Sky, which is the housing project in Calcutta that we are doing. We have been people who have lived collectively in public spaces, and streets, otlas, and verandas have been the essence of our cities because we have lived so much in the public realm. So this is what a normal skyscraper looks like these days. And then one said that now that whole idea of a street, of the urban fabric, you know, what you call fabric has gone missing. When you grow vertically, you don't get fabric. You get a stack of buildings as opposed to a continuation of fabric. When you build horizontally like this, you get fabric. You're putting houses next to each other, and there's a certain relationship to the ground and a certain relationship between the buildings, that houses that are being built. But when you build vertically, then that relationship sort of seems to get lost. And all of this kind of life that occurs because of these otlas and things, of these shared spaces, that sort of disappears. And how do we get that back? So how does one connect back to the city? These were the two main concerns. How does one connect back to the city? And what kind of an urban fabric does one create when one builds vertically? So this is exactly saying that the fact is that, again, looking at the idea of gathering and the role of these sort of, you know, I'm always looking at history, and not necessarily only the vernacular, but historically how we are built and the role of the elements that have emerged through history, because we have been a community-driven society here in India. The elements that have come out of that sort of social structuring. So there's a lack of shared open spaces. There's a lack of sense of visual connectivity between blocks. And each block is separate and isolated. And there's a lack of sense of ground and lack of both greens that are privately owned and that are public. And then there's a lack of those kind of elements which are there, which are crucial to sort of social adhesion. So then one looked at the solution of how does one open up the building mass. See, this is being done for a developer. So we had to be very careful with the figures and everything because they need to, and it has to be saleable. So it's within those same constraints. How does one create porosity? Because that is what was lacking. So we looked at how does one create porosity and how does one make it possible so that one starts from the ground and can climb up all the way to the terrace. And then one is able to connect back from the tower going through a series of public spaces. How is one able to, so this diagram kind of illustrates that if one walks across over vertically through the building, how does one be able to do that through public spaces? And the second is how does one connect back to the city? So this is what it resulted in, that you get all of these public green spaces, there are 25 gardens that are there. And at the top, you get the common amenities which are there. And in between, in the public gardens, there are certain inserts, which are these 1 BHK units and so on. So these are some of the figures just showing the number of houses that are being built and so on and so forth. But this is the kind of build form that emerges, that one gets this continuous sort of street that one can traverse starting from the ground all the way to the top. And that's the sort of kind of elevation that was generated through the exercise. And this is just a rendering of what the public space may look like. So you get these terraces on different levels, and they're all interconnected. The terraces are all interconnected, as you saw here, or as you can see here. So you get this terrace. So this is just a view through a corner terrace. And so one can start from the ground and walk all the way up. So it's a spiral, and one can go all the way up. And then one comes here, and then at the top, there's an amphitheater, and with the stage for performances, and there's a pool and the public amenities with the sports gym and so on, which comes under. So from sitting here, one gets the best view of the city. And every time one goes through the building, one is always able to one look out a lot more, and sit to gather and to be able to look out is still something that is possible in these kind of spaces. And so this is just an interior rendering of what the project will look like. This is also right now under construction in Calcutta. The next project I'm going to be talking about is a culture of roofs and trees, which is a school in Chennai that we are doing. And so if you see a conventional school versus one when one looks at the Buddha and how we got enlightenment under a tree. And I bring this up because the site that we are given has a lot of trees. It has about, so this is an image of the site. It has one of the oldest banyan trees in Chennai, and it has I think 1450 trees that are there that exist on site. And one was talking about education, about building a school, and then there is this idea of historically, again, where did education happen? It happened to sit and learn under a tree is something that's been a part of our culture. And then there's the example of the Buddha. And so it has some 1450 trees. The purpose was to retain all of those trees and to build a building which allows you to live amongst the trees, means to study there and have a place that is sheltered. So that's the campus that we are doing. So you can see all the trees that are there. And so we were looking at, also it's in Chennai, a lot of rainfall. So the roof profile that is there, what does one do with the water? And what kind of volume does one create so that one can appreciate the trees? The way the volume is there under a tree. So that's sort of an environment. How does one create that kind of environment for the students? And that's also another rendering. This is also, this I think the first phase we'll end with construction in about another 8 months or so. And this is another rendering which shows the kind of space that's there under the roofs, under the canopy. So that's why it's a culture of roofs, because it's all about the canopy, that sort of, how do you create a structure which is like a canopy, like a tree canopy. So that's another rendering which shows the campus that's there. So I think my presentation throughout sort of looked at, had an approach, our approach to design is we look at a present problem, then we look at the wisdom of history that's there. We look back at history, how are things being done, the idea of the typology. The present problem, we look at the site that is there and the demands of the client that are there. And then we applied it to future needs. We also look at how like if you're looking at education, what will the future of education be? Or we are looking at a house, then what will the future of a home or like a farmhouse particularly be, or of a row house be? So I thought that these were just certain projects that I could share. And I would like to thank you for this. And thank you, C3 Collaborative, for having me over.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful webinar. You did keep it short, but that was really beautiful and it was quite knowledgeable. as we have started with our sir's speech, I would really like our members, and I would really like to start our Q&A sessions. So members, if you have any questions, you can just, there's an option below as a reaction. You can just raise your hand and I will unmute you to ask your questions. Or you can just type your questions in our chat and I can read it and ask sir directly. Till the time we have those questions, sir, I have a few collected from our members, basically. So the first question is, how green spaces can be integrated in vertical arising structures?
Yeah, so one is green spaces. One is, of course, the provision of green spaces. Other is who's going to be maintaining those green spaces and so on and so forth. But the other is, I think, to give spaces which are not only green, but which are public in nature and where people can sit and gather. And green spaces can be integrated in multiple ways. One is, first is you need to create porosity. So in the dense sort of vertical building that we build, you need to create porosity and create more than just, you know, you create these very shallow balconies where you put some plants. That's, rather than having that, you give ample space for greenery so that you're not, it's not just a visual spectacle, but you actually can be inside that green space. And there's a space for gathering. That is what was attempted with the Pukur in the Sky project.
Okay, that's perfect. And the second question that we had is, if a budget of a client gets increased, how can it be controlled without losing the sustainability factor?
How can it be controlled? Well, one thing about sustainability is, if you are sourcing things which are local and so forth, one is you do build frugally. And that means you probably won't be exceeding. If you are exceeding your budget, you need to look at whether you're truly being sustainable or not. Because more money spent, oftentimes, one is, there are two aspects to it. One is, more money spent, you need to see whether are you spending your money properly or not. Because it may be an indicator of the fact that you are not being very environmentally friendly with the choice of your materials and so on, or construction technology that you're employing. Over. The second part is, you need to do a calculation which looks at long-term versus short-term. So if you're doing a long-term calculation, is it still, you need to explain that to the client that, look, if it's a long-term investment, you're actually saving this much. And if you're able to explain that to the client, then through reasoning, you can convince the client.
That's perfect, sir. That's a perfect reply, I guess. You know, if you're looking at someone to get a perfect reply, I will be definitely looking at you at these matters. Certainly another point, you know, whenever you're working on a project and you face a problem, or, you know, you're facing any challenges, what is the procedure that you take to, you know, overcome such challenges, or, you know, any challenges that you face?
Yeah, so challenges are always there. I don't think there is any project that's done without challenges. The point is, I think one has to study the nature of the challenge, whether it's a technical problem and you need to get somebody else on board to help you solve that problem. Sometimes it's, you need to, like you need to collaborate with somebody else. Maybe there's a need for that. Maybe you're not the expert to solve that kind of problem. Or sometimes go a few steps back and reanalyze your design. And maybe that problem may be able to disappear if you change something in the process of design. You've done something in the past, a certain decision has been taken. If you're able to change that, tweak a little decision there, maybe that problem may disappear. Like with budget, that happens very often. Even with environmental things, sometimes you want two things and you have to make a choice, and you made one choice, but now, like, you put glass in the wrong place or something like that. And then what will happen is that, yeah, it will create, and now you'll have to look for DGU units, and maybe that's causing the budget to go up. So then you look at that decision that you made in the past, correct it there. And hopefully that challenge will become simpler, at least. If it will not disappear, it will become simpler.
Okay. So, sir, there's another question of ours by Dikshit, sir. He has asked, how do you define landscape in your term? If you wanted to put it in your words, basically, how would you define landscape?
I think that's a very good question. Because, for me, the landscape is both the built environment, it's everything over the earth that's there, that's occupied. That's the building and the environment outside, both for me are landscape. And I think, I don't think of the built mass as separate from the landscape. That's an addition to the landscape. We are constantly adding to the landscape of the earth that's been there. And we're just this is a process of evolution. What is commonly known as terraforming, there is a process of evolution of the landscape. So for me, landscape is everything. The house that I build, the outside that's there, both, everything is part of the landscape. Actually, one part I didn't mention was like there are fields. This first house that I did, there used to be fields there, agricultural land, and became non-agricultural land. Someone did a plotting scheme. So that was one kind of change. That was change in land use. That was also a change in landscape. Then I had to build a building on it. So that's exactly what I was thinking of. That, you know, this change that's constantly happening. What is my role in that change that happens? So when I say, can you traverse over the same piece of land? Can you see through the same piece of land the way one could before? This relationship between the trees and so on and so forth. And there's a field actually. So this is the last plot in this thing. And there's a field right next to this. That's why the building plan, if you see, it is built as a C. It doesn't enclose a court the way you do in an urban scenario, where you have houses on all sides and there's a court in between. It's a C profile of the house. The buildings have been separated because one side, there's still a field which is there. So, yeah.
So coming to the next question, sir, these are really spot on answers, by the way. And according to me, these are really tough questions and you've been answering as if there's nothing. So that really shows how knowledgeable and experienced you are in these particular matters. And that's really great. Coming to our next question, sir. Our professional has asked what materials are best to use in sustainable architecture and why. What are the best materials in sustainable architecture and why?
Again, I would say I don't think there's like a very simple answer to that, because I think all of these things, like I said, you know, earlier, the challenges between all, it's a question of evaluation. One material may be better suited for a certain project. One may be better means, where are you building? Of course, that's a question. What materials are available, like for the previous sort of sustainability question, which is there. Then also the fact that certain materials, yes, what goes into the maintenance or upkeep of a building after it has been built. So you need to factor that in also. When you're looking at materials, like this house that I did, there was lime plaster. I'd use lime plaster. It helps keep the building cool and so forth. But then you realize that there are issues with lime plaster. It comes from Rajasthan, but here there's greater rainfall. So it causes certain issues, upkeep, and so on and so forth. So, yeah, you have to actually evaluate, I would say. Evaluate a lot of factors when you're looking at what is more sustainable. There is no sort of clear answer that this material is more sustainable than the other. Yes, as larger globally, if you look at what material contributes most to pollution, yes, there is a clear answer to that. There's a statistical answer to that, because of how much it is used, what goes into making that material. Those answers you will easily be able to find. But what material to use and which is more sustainable for your project, that requires evaluation.
That's great. You know, as another question is there, I think we're getting back-to-back questions with this particular topic. It's quite interesting. So with an increasing threat of global warming, how green awareness can be created in the common world?
Green awareness, I think there is one is education system, obviously, subjects in college. So I used to teach at Nirma University here in Ahmedabad. I used to teach the structure, the technical subject I used to teach there. So I think one is including there is also an environment subject which is there. So I think that training is very useful. One is not only having awareness, but technical know-how. Also talking to professionals who have the technical know-how. I think if you want to really be sustainable, one is, of course, as an architect, you must educate yourself. You've gone through an education. Read up more, learn more. But also get the right technical professionals involved. Don't take the burden on yourself alone. Because I don't think awareness will solve the problem. There are a lot of people who are very aware. But to get the right people who have the right technical know-how to get involved in your projects is very crucial. Because otherwise, you're not solving the problem. You know the problem, which is like an alarmist sort of attitude. I know the problem. That doesn't solve the problem.
No, to explaining all these things to a professional is much easier, but when you have to explain it to a layman, to your client basically, and you have to explain the entire thing, the entire sustainable structure, how difficult
Yeah.
is it to explain it to them? Like that, I said, that's the basic question that should be there.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think it's always a task to talk to the layman to yes, they are there, you must educate them. If they're not at the right education, you must play that role. And that's your awareness which you must pass on. And you must tell them also about how not because when you talk of a global scenario, the worry gets lost. You talk of a global scenario that the city water levels will rise, this will affect the city, this thing is too far in the distance. But you talk to them because global warming, it happens very slowly. That's why it goes unnoticed. But the thing is, we do notice things like the cycles are changing now, and we notice that those changes are happening with all the cyclones and things that are happening. It's you have to talk about the everyday to them. I think with the client, with the layman, every day, and how you notice in the everyday that there is climate change happening, that will sort of help them understand because that's the easiest way for someone to understand. Lived experience is the best for anyone to understand anything.
That is true. In any which case, sustainable development and sustainable building, that has been there. The entire concept itself is so beautiful. I think the moment you used to show your plan, they used to get attracted with the entire idea and the beauty of the designs and everything. But when it comes to the costing and when it comes to the entire pitching them the entire plan, so how satisfactory has it been? Like, and out of 10, if I tell you out of 10 clients, how many have said, okay, this is really beautiful. And out of like 10, how many have come up with the entire idea? No, I think we should really come down on the budgetary set and, such things.
So I would say with the costing, yeah, you always have to. So I like for me, it's like this. There's the initial diagram, which is the essence of the project. For me, what matters is the essence of the project, like that historical, that this is what has happened historically, and this is what I want to change in the typology is very important to me. Now, is that change I want? Now, the rest of the things I will try to, you have to work around the rest to retain the essence. Things will change. No client, the first house also, you make 20 options. No client gives in. Maybe if you're a very big architect, you have that kind of authority. But no client sort of accepts your proposal at first. You have to work around, first of all, understanding what their needs are. And so you dress up the project in a way which sort of is their language, it's their vision. So it's like you're giving them what they want, but you know what the essence of the project is, and that should not get lost. You rework everything, no matter how many times. Don't lose the essence, that's all. The rest is possible. You have to rework. There is no sort of shying away from that. Like it has to be done.
I can understand if we get it through at the first point, then we do realize, we did something wrong, definitely. If the client accepted it in the first go, then from inside it feels like, no, I think I did something wrong. Let's make it much better. Okay. So with this, I'll be ending the Q&A sessions. And along with that, we'll be coming to a conclusion of our webinar. But before I go, I would like to post all the links as promised. So you guys can go through the entire thing and join our Telegram group. All you have to do is you need to copy the link and paste it on the Telegram application, and you can just have access to unlimited interaction, and you can also talk to professionals, and you can put in your requirements and participate in other activities that we conduct. So thank you so much, Raghuveer sir. It was a really
Thank you so
pleasure to
much for
having
having
you on our platform. And with this, I shall end our session, but you will get the recordings and we will upload the video on YouTube and other on our other social media platforms on Tuesday. Okay, so take
Thank
care,
you so much.
everyone. Thank you so
Thank
much,
you
sir.
everyone for attending.
Please take care, and I shall see you on our other platforms as well.